Number 19.
Thank you.
$799. Walking alone at even, hearing the sighs of a father, in the darkness of doom, welcome me, silver star. I have great delight in the wonderful scenes above. God in his power and might, it is showing his truth and love.
Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning praising you for who you are, God. Thank you for being our God and our Father. Lord, we thank you so much for your church, not only here in this congregation, but your church across the world. Lord, thank you that you allowed us to be a part of your church. Lord, we come to you this morning rejoicing with Eric and Jill Tuckerdale as they celebrate new life in their family. We ask your blessings to be upon them. They continue to raise this child, Lord, that they will raise this child to know and love you. God, we pray for those who are in our congregation, Lord, who have health issues, those that need your help, Lord, that have lifted up to you. Pray that you'll give him healing, Lord. Pray that you will be with him and the doctors and nurses that attend to him. And be with his family, Lord, give them peace and comfort for this time, and let them know that you are there. God, we thank you for the success of David Smith's surgery, and that you'll continue to be with him and as he fights this disease. Pray for Sam, you, Lord God, and them. They have continued health issues and they need your help, Lord. We pray that you, as a church, be encouragement to them and encouragement to all the other Lord who are praying for our folks to lift them up, Lord, not only to you, but to encourage them in this evening and also in the church. Lord, we lift up Margie Allison, pray that you will be with her as she goes for tests, God. Pray that everything will work out and her health will be restored, God. We also pray that you'll receive all things to go into surgery this week, Lord, and she'll be the doctors and nurses into the surgeries that be successful for him. Now, there are others who are on this prayer list who have in our church health issues, got issues going on with their family, Lord. We lift up those. We pray that as a church we'll be encouragement for all of them. Lord, as we come before you in worship this morning, we pray that you'll help our hearts and our minds to focus on you, Lord, and pay attention to the sermon, listen to it, so we can apply it to our lives, Lord, and to heart. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus, Lord. Amen. Scripture this morning comes from Psalms 104, verses 24, and then 23 and 30. How many of your works, O Lord? In wisdom you made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. May my meditation be pleasing to him as I rejoice in the Lord.
Number 352. This morning, as we prepare our minds to take the Lord's Supper, we'll sing the first verse, 352. What counter is mountains on one dreadful Lord?
Thank you.
889.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see everyone here with us tonight. We have quite a few visitors. We're certainly glad that you have come our way. It was very special. And our guests, and hope you come back with us at every opportunity you might have. Sometimes, if we're not careful, we tend to think the creation account is contained in Genesis chapters 1 and 2. And we tend to forget that spatter throughout Scripture, both Old and New Testament, there are passages that look back to that time. And yet, perhaps David, and if not someone near his time, chose to sit down and write an entire psalm regarding the creation of God. So if you have your Bibles, turn to Psalms 104, because that's where we're going to land this morning. In verse 1, the Bible tells us, "Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord my God, you are very great, and you are clothed with honor and majesty." And then, of course, as Danny read earlier, the psalmist, as he is wrapping up this material, will talk about the manifold works of God and how the people praise and honor God always for those things. So let's see what the psalmist has to say here about God's creation. And as he begins, he uses an interesting term. God stretched out the heavens. Verse 2, "You who cover yourself with light as with a garment, who stretch out the heavens like a curtain." We don't even know how big creation is. I mean, think about people in the time of David. They had limited knowledge of what was around the earth. We have telescopes, and we've sent out space probes and so on, and we have a better idea. And yet, scientists tell us we've not touched the hem of the garment as to how big the universe really is. And sometimes we look at that and we realize human beings will probably never have the capacity to travel from one end of the universe to the other. So why did God stretch it out like that? Why did God make it so big? There's simple answer. Because he wanted to. Because he could. And sometimes we limit ourselves to the word creator, and maybe other times we ought to think of God as not just simply the creator, but a master artist of design. And you know, sometimes artists just do works because they want to create those works. And God did. Keep that thought in mind. Isaiah 42 and verse 5, "Thus says the Lord God who created the heavens and stretched them out." They're limitless. And yet, our God did that with the word. He also laid the foundations of the earth. Beginning in verse 5, "Who laid the foundations of the earth so that it would not be moved forever. You covered it with the deep as with a garment. The water stood above the mountains at your voice in the land. At the voice of your thunder, they hastened away. They went up over the mountains. They went down into the valleys to the place you founded for them. You have set a boundary that they may not pass over, that they may not return to cover the earth." Genesis tells us the earth was by water, and God named the dry lands and things. And so, he specialized, shall we say, with one plan. He made it the one that he really wanted to concentrate on. And he had some very, very, very special things in store for that one plan. And Job wanted to question God about God's care and providence and so on. And God asked him a very telling question. In Job 38:4, he said, "Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth?" You know, I bet God was really glad he hadn't created a human being before he created the earth. You know why? That one human being would have probably been standing there telling God how to do it. Wow! Wouldn't that be presumptuous for us to tell God how to do something? Well, we probably would. You know, maybe I ought to make a little different shade of green, or maybe a few less rocks, or whatever. We weren't there. God got to use his creative genius with what he did. But then, on this earth, the psalmist goes on to tell us that God provides for his creatures. Verses 10 and 14. He sends springs into the valleys which flow among the hills. He causes grass to grow for cattle and vegetation for the service of man, that he may bring forth food from the earth. And so, God didn't put all of these creatures all over the earth, and they had to just care for themselves. They had to come up with a way of survival. God provided what was necessary and what they needed. Water, food, all that the animals might need. In fact, again, when he was talking to Job in chapter 38, verse 41, he says, God provides food for the raven. Jesus will come along later on and emphasize the point that God feeds the birds of the air. And so we know that God does provide for and cares for his various creatures. And then we've got a little interesting creation up there. We call it the moon. In verse 19, it says, he appointed the moon for seasons. The sun knows it's going down. Long time, people didn't understand that. Even though most of the early world was on what we would call the lunar calendar rather than the solar calendar. The moon controls tides. I mean, you know, it's kind of a weird device anyway. One time we look up in the sky and there's a whole disk, and then we look up in the sky at other times and there's just kind of a little Cheshire Cat smile looking at us. But God created the moon with a great purpose. In Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 35, we're told, thus says the Lord, who gives the sun for a light by day, and the ordinances of the moon and the stars for a light by night. Mariners chart with the stars. They used them to know where they were as they were traveling on the seas. And so God thought about all of these things long before the end. Excuse me, ever put man upon the earth. And then, God created a bunch of stuff in the ocean. Verse 25, the great and wide sea in which are innumerable things teeming, living things both small and great. Think about the ocean, creature. You know, God created some little bitty fish. We call them tropical fish. Lots of people like to have aquariums. You get these things, I mean, you get what they call a fancy tailed guppy, and it's got this big tail and colors in it, and there's a neon tetra, and it, boy, it looks like it's glowing in the dark with its brilliant blue and red color. They're yellow fish, and they're blue fish, and then there's what they call a zebra fish, and it's striped like a zebra, boy. It just swims around in there, and then he created catfish to kind of clean things up. And then God created fish that are in the depths of the ocean where human beings don't even have a means of going. And it was interesting, something I was taught about seafaring now. I think going down in a ship that sinks is not smart. But, you know, that's just my opinion. But I'm told when a new crew comes on a submarine that generally one of the people in the engine room is going to wind up running the cord from one side of the ship to the other. And that cord will be tight when the ship is above the surface. But when that thing dives down under the ocean and they start getting down several hundred feet, it actually compresses the sides on that submarine, and that cord will sag in the middle. When you get too much pressure on the sub, it's going to explode and sink. And yet God has created creatures that roam far below any depths that we as human beings can go. And again, people say, why? Well, he can see that. He sees these creatures. He created them for his pleasure and for his enjoyment. And again, the Bible emphasizes in Psalms 95, verse 4 and 5, in his hand are the deep places of the earth. The sea is his. And he made it. So God really set up a wonderful, spectacular place. And why? Well, bottom line, God did it for his own glory. Verse 31. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. Think about the end of Genesis chapter 1. God looked on all the things that he had made, and behold, they were very good. Now, I'm not a great artist. You're never going to see some painting I did going up for auction for millions of dollars ever. If I create something, I back up and think, wow, I had an accident, this worked out. When God creates something, he backs up and looks at it and says, isn't that great? Isn't that wonderful? Didn't I do a masterful work here? I've been alluding to something throughout this lesson. Proverbs 16, verse 4 tells us, the Lord made all things for himself. There's our bottom line. God created all of these magnificent things that we see and we enjoy because he wanted to. Because it was in his creative mind and ability. And it wasn't by accident. It was by design. Proverbs 8 and verse 22. And by the way, in this chapter, wisdom is being personified. And so, this verse says, the Lord possessed me at the beginning of his way, before his works alone. God possessed wisdom. What he made the worlds out of were made out of wisdom. Wasn't a happenstance, it wasn't a chance. It wasn't an accident. It was the deliberate intent of an amazing creative mind. And when we come to the New Testament, there's a wonderful passage there, and when people say, well, if we're going to talk about things, we ought to use logic, okay? Please, let me use logic. The Hebrew writer did. In chapter 3 and verse 4, the Hebrew writer said, for every house is built by someone, but he who builds all things is God. Now, no one's going to drive by this building and look at it and say, wow, what a wonderful accident that was. All of a sudden, this yellow brick building just grew up out of the earth. Boy, isn't that neat and special and great and wonderful. Never going to happen. Because people realize it took a builder to build this building. And logic tells us that there had to be a builder. That there had to be a maker. That there was a creator who built all things. This spectacular universe, this wonderful earth, the things that are in the seas, they didn't happen by accident. They happened because of God's wisdom and nature. Now, why would I present a lesson like this today? I mean, I don't think I'm going to have debates with any of you going out today that God's not creator. So, what's important about all of this? What is important is actually the rest of the story. That in spite of this amazing creation that's bigger than anything we as human beings can imagine, is God who cares for us. Psalms 33, verse 13. The Lord looks from heaven. He sees all the sons of men. Now, some people look at that and say, man, that's a negative thing. God's up there spying on my life. No. Do you not realize how totally special that is? The God who put all of this creative system to work knows you. And he knows me. This God told Jeremiah that he knew him before he was conceived in the womb. We're not talking about somebody that's unaware of what's going on. We're talking about somebody that knows exactly what's going on. God knows when some poor African mother is having to flee a warlord and she's got to walk 200 miles with no water, no food, and two children to get away from the warlords and try to get to a refugee camp. God knows when she gets to a point and she sits down and can't go any further. And she's sitting there pondering which child she's going to leave behind to die. God knows that. God didn't forget about Job. Job thought he did. But God did. God knew exactly what was going on in Job's life. God knows when we rejoice. God knows when we struggle. God knows when a parent's laying awake at night worried over their child, concerned about what's going on in their life. God knows what that parent is going through. God knows not only what an individual dealing with an illness goes through, but what their family goes through with them and their struggles and their suffering. God sees all of those things. They're not hidden from Him. They're not out of sight. Jesus talked about the fact in the Sermon on the Mount that two sparrows were sold for a copper coin and one fell on the ground. God knew.
And certainly on the plain from Luke, he talks about five sparrows being sold for two copper coins. And it's the free sparrow fell on the ground. God knew it. God knows what's going on in our lives. God sees. God understands. And God doesn't forget about us. Because Psalms 37:28 says, the Lord loves justice, and He is always just, and does not forsake His saints. God's not going to forget about any one of us. And creation amazes me. But this fact of God amazes me. He knows all of us, isn't He? If we ascended up to heaven, He would be there. If we could go to the depths of the sea, He would be there. When Elijah ran away and was hiding in a cave and wanting to die, or David was hiding in the caves of Gedi, God knew about those things. God knows your struggles. God knows your triumphs. God knows your illnesses and what you're dealing with in life, and He cares so much. According to Paul, He came in the flesh. And He lived among us perfectly, that He might become a perfect sacrifice. So one day, we could go and be with God forever. I don't know about you. That's an amazing thing that we care that much about each and every one of us. And that amazing being today wants you to become His child. He wants you to believe on Jesus with all of your heart, for you to repent of your sins, confess your faith in Christ, be buried in the waters of baptism in contact with the blood of Jesus. To be raised to walk in the newness of life. God wants that for people. And if you're here today and you happen to be an erring child of God, well, God doesn't care anymore. Yes, He does. He's still watching you. He's still caring for you. He still wants you to come back. Be restored in fellowship to Him once again. So God that's big enough to oversee the universe and the depths of the sea is also caring enough that He knows about you and me. If you've never come to Christ, please do so. As we said.